This is a live Bible question and answer program where you, the radio listeners, can call in to this radio station with Bible questions or comments and receive Bible answers and questions to those comments. We have three gospel preachers on the panel this afternoon, ready and able to give you book, chapter, and verse for your Bible question. We have our brother Dwayne Hamilton, who's of the Wilson Road Church of Christ. I am Henry Stevenson, one of the preachers to the Goose Creek Church of Christ here in Baytown, Texas. We have brother Stephen Ozan, who is the minister to the Wilson Road Church of Christ there in Humboldt, Texas. We have our brother Javier, who is recording our session, as he's done in the past, where you can also pull up other broadcasts that we've done on the World Wide Web. You go to YouTube, pull up Wilson, RDCOC. We have brother Robert Lewis in the audience, in the studio audience, who is a member of the Goose Creek Church of Christ, as well as our brother Chuck Ledet, who is a member of the Goose Creek Church of Christ. And we have our brother Edwin Russell in the audience as well, who is a member at the Central Church of Christ there in Baytown, Texas. And Luke chapter 6, verse 46 through 49. The Bible writes, "And why call you me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? Whosoever cometh to me and heareth my sayings and doeth them, I will show you unto whom he is like. He is like a man which built a house and dig deep, laid the foundation on a rock, and when the flood arose and the stream beat vehemently," the Bible says, "upon that house, it could not shake it, for it was founded upon a rock. But he that heareth and doeth not is like a man without a foundation, built a house upon the earth, against which the stream did beat vehemently, and immediately it fell, and the ruin of that house was great." Now, I'm almost certain yesterday, many of you who are under the sound of my voice is aware of a doctrine that was propagated by some man by the name of Harold Camping. He had made a predicament, a prophecy, or a calculation from his interpretation of the scripture that, in fact, the world was going to end. That, in fact, a rapture was going to take place where all the righteous living and the righteous dead were to be caught up in the air and meet the Lord there. And those of us left, would be experiencing what is called the seven-year tribulation. Now, some of you may mock Mr. Harold Camping. Some of you may now be belittling him and probably even concocting in your mind that he is foolish and even his doctrine is foolish. But let me say this while we're in the neighborhood on this subject. Harold Camping is no different than those in our religious world today, in our world, who are propagating things as well that contradicts the Bible.
Amen.
He is no different than these men and these women who get on television and radio programs who concoct in their mind that a sinner's prayer is all one has to do and say in order to be called and become a child of God. Harold Camping is no different than those who propagate that it's okay for you to take the Lord's Supper just once a month. Harold Camping is no different than those who propagate that baptism is not a necessity for salvation. Harold Camping is no different than those who believe that it's all right for you to call your preacher a reverend. And so if you're saying that Harold Camping is foolish and his doctrine is foolish, you would be right in saying that. But may I suggest to you and I this afternoon, Harold Camping is not the only one out there with a foolish doctrine. See, Harold Camping's teaching can and will lead those who eat of it and partake of it and digest it and live by it. He will cause you to lose your soul in a devil's hell, just like those who propagate a sinner's prayer. Those who propagate that baptism is not a necessity for salvation. Those who believe that it's okay to call their preacher a reverend. Those who believe that it's all right to have instrument in their worship service and practices to Almighty God. And so I would plead with you to understand and realize that Harold Camping is in the same predicament as all these other false teachers that I'm persuaded that some of you follow that are listening to this program this afternoon.
That's right.
That is a false doctrine, and so is these other things that I have just mentioned to you this afternoon.
Amen.
They will lead you to a devil's hell.
Amen.
However, there was a lot of people, radio listeners, who believe what Harold Camping said on yesterday.
That's right.
They believe what they heard. But the problem is what they heard is not from the Word of God. It is not rightly divided. The Bible explicitly tells us in Matthew 24, and I'm speaking about the resurrection, in Matthew 24 and verse number 36, and then I'm going to toss it to one of these good brethren to elaborate more perhaps on this subject or perhaps something else. Matthew 24, 36, but of that day and hour knoweth no man, not the angels in heaven, but my Father only.
Amen.
And so the Bible has made it very clear. These are the words of Jesus. Jesus tells us that he doesn't even know the day or the hour when he will come back, but it's in the hand of his Father. Not even the angels in heaven know. But you know how we knew that Harold Camping was wrong? Because we believe the scriptures.
Amen.
There should not have been a doubt in those of us who are members of the body of Christ that Harold Camping, even if Jesus had come back, it wasn't going to be because Harold Camping predicted it. It would have happened just because it was God's plan for it to happen. But no man knows the day or the hour when it's going to happen. The Bible tells us when Jesus comes back, he is going to come back like a thief in the night. A thief doesn't let you know when he's going to break in your house,
does he? That's right.
He doesn't let you know, I'm coming to your house, I'm going to break in today. He doesn't give you that warning. Jesus is letting us know that what we need to do, those of us who desire to go to heaven, we need to be preparing ourselves. We need to be ready because we don't know the day or the hour. But let me say this to those of you who are listening. Harold Camping was wrong. But those of us who are members of the body of Christ, I'm going to speak to you first. Don't you stop watching.
Amen.
You keep watching because I want you to know one day, at a day and an hour that we are not aware of, Jesus Christ is going to come back. And he's only coming back, get this, for the rest of you who are not members of the body of Christ. He's only coming back for his one bride, his one church, and that is the church of Christ. He doesn't have a multitude of loose living women, and there's a lot of loose living women in this world called religions and denominations.
Amen.
But Jesus has one bride. He has one people, one church that he's coming back for, and she is the church of Christ. And if you're not a member of the people of God, the people of Christ, the body of Christ that you can read about in the scriptures, then my friend, when Jesus does come back, I want you to know you're not ready. If you're wearing the name Baptist, Catholic, Presbyterian, Methodist, I want you to know you're not ready.
That's right.
Because you're not a member of the body, the church, that we can read about in the scriptures. You believe what you hear, but is what you hear in the Word of God. Now, before I toss it, I'm going to toss a question to you radio listeners. And this question is one that you hear propagated on a lot of radio programs, and this is not eliminated from one of those radio programs, this sinner's prayer. See, if you believe that you were saved and you became a Christian by repeating a prayer after some man or some woman, you ought to thank God that he did not come yesterday. You ought to thank God that he is long-suffering.
Amen.
And he's patient, because if you believe that doctrine of sinner's prayer, then you are not ready for the return of Christ.
Amen.
Because a sinner's prayer doesn't wash away your sins. A sinner's prayer does not put you in the body of Christ, and you are not saved. See, that is a foolish doctrine. It is a false doctrine.
Amen.
And it's just as false as what Harold Camping propagated about May the 21st, that the world was going to end. You know how we know Harold was wrong? Because the Bible tells us that he was wrong. You know how we know a sinner's prayer is wrong? Because the Bible tells us that a sinner's prayer is wrong, and a sinner's prayer does not wash away sins. Now, the number to call is 281-837-2222. 281-837-2222. We're opening the lines for any questions or any comment that you can make or that you have about what's been said within the last 10 minutes of this broadcast. At the time, I'm going to toss it to Brother Dwayne Hamilton to elaborate more on our subject.
Brother, God bless you for that.
Amen.
You know, we can close the program. We can
Amen.
Go home now. And since we paid for 20 more minutes, we're going to go ahead and hear this. But, brother, I was on the internet, and I was looking at, I didn't even hear about that foolishness until, maybe a couple of days before, maybe it was a day or two before. I have overheard some guys at work talking about what they're going to be doing, whatever it's going to be. And having to go on the internet and see it for myself. And I immediately thought, what kind of foolishness is this, you know? And then my second thought was that there are going to be people that are going to really be believing this. And that made me sad, you know? Then I saw the comments that people were making about the article. And people were like, he says he's read the Bible, but he's obviously not reading it enough. Or the Bible says that no man knows when the day will come. And this and that and that and this. And then, but the craziest thing of all is that they were able to prove that what he said was not right, because they had read in the Bible somewhere that God, that no man knows the time. But the sad part about it, now, hold on, we're gonna, I know, we'll see, we have a call, we're gonna come to the call in just a second. But the sad part about it is that the same scriptures teach against their beliefs that they hold, but they refuse to let those go.
Amen.
And see, that makes you a hypocrite in the sight of God. We're gonna go to the call.
Amen.
So, go ahead, call, you're on the air.
My question is simple. I began pastoring a church and Living God in Galveston. They were under the General Assembly that instituted water as the substance to drink to represent his blood. And my teaching has been against that. So if you can give me a little insight on that, because I know what the scripture says, that I no longer partake of the fruit of the vine. I know that water didn't come out of the vine. So instead of giving the flock that I oversee water, I give them grape juice, because I believe grape juice came from the vine. Can you enlighten me on that, please, sir?
Yeah. Hold on, sir. If you could, maybe I didn't catch his question. It sounded like he was saying that they were taking water from the Lord's Supper.
Right. I think that's where. Is he still on the line? Did you hang up, sir? Okay. Is that correct? You're saying that they substitute water for the fruit of the vine.
Yeah, they used water instead of most churches use grape juice. I think Catholic churches use wine. And my teaching does not teach me that. My learning does not teach me.
Okay, sir. Now, I appreciate you calling. We're going to deal with this, but let me, first of all, you've given some clues to some of your doctrine, and that is, first of all, you said the Church of the Living God. Let me tell you something about a name. Usually identifies a person's doctrine, and so when you say Church of the Living God, that of course we know is not the people that we see in the Word of God. But let me first of all deal with your question. You made a statement of my teaching, and what we want to give you is not our teaching, and this is what's crucial. It's the Word of God's teaching on every subject. And can you hear me, sir? Yes, the Word of God's teaching. No, you can stay on if you choose. I don't think we have another call. But let me give you what Jesus did in Matthew 26 and verses 26 through 29. And we're going to show here that it's not water. That's where poor studies come in. When people say they use water, they're going to have to show a biblical example. An approved example, a direct command, something that's inferred that anybody took water in place of the fruit of the vine. And so if they have no Bible for it, that means their doctrine is shot.
Right.
And so in Matthew 26:26, this is Jesus instituting the Lord's Supper. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it, and he gave to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. But I say unto you, I will not drink for it hence of this water." That's not what it says. It says, "Of this fruit of the vine, amen, until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." Mm-hmm. And so now the burden of proof is on them, the proof that we need to take water in place of the fruit of the vine. And so, you know, one thing we don't do on this program, and I, even in my studies, is I don't spend much time wrestling with counterfeit doctrine and trying to figure out their foolishness. Amen. You know, they even teach bank tellers that. You know, bank tellers, they don't study counterfeit money. You know why? Because it can always change. So, but if you study the real thing, you can always know when the counterfeit comes your way, because you study the real denomination of money. And so we don't spend time in our studies with all these ungodly doctrines. What we do on this program, as well as our Bible teaching, is we give people the truth. And if you give people truth, it will eliminate all error.
Amen.
And so the burden of proof, thank you, sir. And so the burden of proof is on them to show in the Bible anybody use water as a substitute for the fruit of the vine. We thank you for your call, sir.
Thank you.
If you believe in a sinner's prayer, I can't stress this enough, that's being propagated by the new lights, the bright lights, the late woods, the radio stations, and the television stations, my friend, you're going to die lost. You are not going to make heaven your home believing that all you had to do was say a sinner's prayer, ask Jesus to come in your heart, and go to heaven. That's not a doctrine that we find taught in the scripture. If you believe it's okay to call your preacher reverend, you're going to die lost. If you don't think baptism is a necessity, that you have to do it for your salvation, then you are going to die lost. 2 John verse 9, and the Bible tells us, whosoever transgressed and abided not in the doctrine of Christ had not God. He that abided in the doctrine, the teaching of Christ, he had both the Father and the Son. Okay, and so doctrine is very important. You can't belong to any church and think that all churches are just taking different paths to go to heaven. That's taught nowhere in the scriptures. Again, we're talking about you believe what you hear, but is what you hear from the Word of God? Is it rightly divided? We have another caller on the line, and we want to address this caller's question. Go ahead, caller, you're on the air. Yes, sir.
Okay, good. I just got cut off.
Okay, thank you for calling back.
The question I'm asking is, I hear a lot of women preachers on the radio now, calling themselves pastors over the churches and things of this nature. There was a scripture that was thrown down about young men having dreams, women prophesizing, and they was using it to say that they feel doing the right to preach.
Okay, thank you for calling, sir. And again, that is also another, and I should add that to the list of ungodly doctrines and people believing what they hear, but they can't find it in the Word of God. Now, the Apostle Paul emphatically tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 14. 1 Corinthians, I'm hearing a phone ring. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, and I want to begin first at verse 33, where Jesus, or God, Paul writes to the saints in Corinth. He says, for God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all churches of the saints. Let your women keep silence in the churches, for it is not permitted unto them to speak, but they are commanded, get that, to be under obedience, as also said the law. Now, you have to understand something here. It's not the church of Christ, not the men in the church of Christ, that say that women aren't to preach. The Word of God has told us that they are commanded not to speak. Amen. Now, that word speak there doesn't mean that they can't say anything. You have to understand they are commanded to sing when they come into the building. That word speak simply is saying they are not allowed to stand up and give a public dissertation. Amen. They do not have the authority to stand up before the public assembly and preach to that congregation. They are commanded to be under obedience. Verse 35, and if there are any, if they will learn anything, let them ask their husbands at home, for it is a shame for women, here it is again, to speak in the church. What? Came the word of God out from you, or came it unto you only? He says in verse 37 of 1 Corinthians 14, if any man think himself to be a prophet or spiritual, let him acknowledge, now this is what Paul says, that the things that I write unto you are the commandments of the Lord. Now, he didn't say anything about it was culture. Paul is not a male chauvinist.
Amen.
He didn't say that was just for his day and for his time. He said they are commanded. It is a commandment of the Lord. And so women who are trying to propagate that they have the ability and perhaps they do have a communication skills, and maybe they can be leaders in secular occupation, but when it comes to the Lord's church, the Lord has already prescribed in His Word how things ought to be done.
Amen.
And I don't have a right, and you don't have a right, and they don't have a right to change what is written on the pages of inspiration. Now that word pastor, which is a terminology that's being torn up by the denominational world, is not a word that is for a preacher. The word pastor is the same as an elder.
That's right.
It's a bishop. It's a presbyter. It is an overseer. There is no such thing, and you can't find it not one time in the Bible, of a woman pastor.
Amen.
The qualification for a pastor or an elder or a bishop is found in the scriptures. 1 Timothy chapter 3 is one of those places. A bishop then must be blameless, get this, the husband of one wife. Now, how does a woman meet that qualification? My friend, there are no women elders. There are no women pastors. There are no women overseers, at least not in the Church of Christ.
Amen.
And it ought not be in the church. Now, the denominations, they're doing some and any of everything that they want to do in those denominations. They have an ushers, names that they've made up, ushers you don't find nowhere in the Bible, deaconess as these offices that you don't find anywhere in the Bible. They have women elders, women pastors, but let me say this, in the Church of Jesus Christ, The people, the body of Christ, Christ has outlined in his word how he wants the church to be
his church.
Operating. That's right. It's his church.
Amen.
It belongs to him. And that's why we call ourselves the church of Christ. The people of Christ. Amen. The body of Christ. Because the church don't belong to not one of these brethren sitting here on this panel.
Amen.
Or one of these brethren that's
Amen.
Sitting in this studio audience.
Amen.
We and the members of the body of Christ, we let the Bible speak and be the authority on everything that we teach and on everything that we believe. And see, if you stick with that, radio listener, this is the point we're trying to make. You won't fall hook, line, and sinker for all of these ungodly doctrines that you find out there in the world today. There are no prophets today. There were women prophetess. Now, I think he brought up prophetess. When the church was in its infancy stage, before we had the complete written word of God, yes, there were women prophetess. Yes, there were prophets. Yes, there was a dispensation, a time where miraculous gifts were in place and were needful. But today, we have everything that we need pertaining to life and godliness in the written word of God.
Amen.
Somebody claims to be a prophet today, he's a liar. Just like Harold Camping. The number to call is 281-837-2222.
God bless you, my brother. I want to look at Romans chapter 3, and I want to read verse 3 and verse 4. You know, and you know, we thank the callers for calling in, but we want people to understand, you know, when you call in, you ask that question, and you give an answer from the scriptures, you know. But here's the thing that everybody needs to understand, and that saints, all saints need to always remember, is that it is our obligation to submit ourselves to the Word of God.
Amen.
The whole
That's
counsel
right.
of God. When I say that, I mean even the parts that you may not necessarily agree with or like. It may not be a part of your personal preference, but every person must submit themselves to what God has said and make it your personal preference.
Amen.
It's not because, see, you know, like I said, you go on the internet, the people on the internet, oh, he doesn't know what he's talking about. He's a false prophet. The Bible is clear. No man knows what. But yeah, you can go to the Bible, you can prove that's wrong. And you say amen. But then you go to the same scripture and teach that women shouldn't preach, or that there is no such thing as a sinner's prayer, and you fight that tooth and nail.
Amen.
That's not what the Bible is saying. No. It's no different. You're no different than this Mr. Camping, whatever guy's name is. You're no different than him now. Y'all in the same boat. And that's the point that we want people to understand. You're so quick to judge this guy. And I'm with you. He is. He has spoken foolishness. And I say amen and amen to that. However, make sure your judgment, people always talk about don't judge. Well, you're judging him just now.
That's right.
But here's the thing. You need to judge according to righteous judgment. If you're going to say he's wrong because he took something, because he said something that wasn't in the Bible, then it's no different than your pastor or your preacher or the people that you know that are saying all these various things that are not in the Bible, ain't never been in the Bible, but you believe him. Because I guess his suit is pretty enough, or what he's promising you like. But it's no different.
Amen.
The Bible says this, and I believe we have a call before we go to just a second. Romans chapter 3, verse 3 and 4 says, "For what if some did not believe? Will their unbelief make the faithfulness of God without effect?"
God
says,
forbid.
"Certainly not, God forbid. Indeed, let God be true and every man a liar, as it is written." He says, this is the purpose. "That you may be justified in your words, and you may overcome when you are judged." And that's the point. That's one of the points of this program. That's why we get on here and say the things that we say. That's why we have Bible for everything that we say, so that when we are judged by God, we can be justified in our sayings.
Amen.
We make sure that we let God be true and every man a liar. It doesn't matter who the man is. You match what he says by the Bible. Just like all these people on the internet saying he's wrong, and you went to the Bible to prove it.
Amen.
It ain't no different than when you need to have the same scrutiny to your preacher or the people that you love, because all that you've done is shown yourself to be a hypocrite. You've shown that you can see when you want to see, but you close your eyes when you want to close your eyes.
Amen.
And God and God have a major problem with you at that time. We have to believe you have a call on the line. Go ahead, call you on the air.
Hello.
Yes.
My name is Willie Hargrove. I am driving now, so I don't have my Bible, but I just want to comment on what you said about women preachers. And it's just that when you interpret the Bible that way, it makes you contradict other areas of the Bible. Remember, Priscilla and Aquila, they explained to Apollos the way of the Word. And then Paul said, "Except those two would labor with me in the gospel." When he was talking to the Corinthians there, he was correcting them of things they were doing. The practice they was practicing right then, Paul was correcting them. When he said what, Why would he write a letter and question himself with the word what? He wouldn't do that. He was referring to what they were saying, that women have the right to preach because God would not, his spirit is not limited. Why would he limit women to not preaching the gospel? And how can they have their husbands at home? Because later on in the Bible, the husband might be unbelieving. So I'm just saying the way people need to watch what they say, because it'll make it contradict something else. So that's all I'm saying.
Okay.
And because plus we're not under the law. He said, as also set the law, it's we're not under the law no more. Christ fulfilled the law, for we won't, because we couldn't. We're under grace and mercy. We're not under the law. So Paul was telling the church back then, you're not under the law. He said, as also set the law, but he was coming what they were saying, because Christ fulfilled the law. We all know that. If it weren't for him fulfilling the law, we would all be lost. We're not under the law anymore. We're under grace and truth.
Sir. We run out of time. We want to ask the caller back at the beginning before we continue. We'll continue that on next week. Call back at the top of the hour, 3:30 next Sunday. I do want to say right before we close that at no point during his dissertation did he bring up any scriptures,
no scriptures.
That he said that we contradicted. He says it also said the law, but the Bible says also says the law, because he's saying now, I'm saying it right now as a part of the new law of Christ. That's why he says, as also says the law. But like I said, we want to let him give him an opportunity to bring forth his points. Please, sir, call back. We're going to deal with it at the top of the program. Through faith, repentance, confession, and baptism, you too can become a child of God. You receive his spirit, which will identify you as one of his when he returns. And of course, there's a stipulation that you must stay faithful until death. We'll leave a faithful saints of God. Stay faithful, brothers and sisters. Romans 16:16, the Church of Christ.
Salute you.